I guess the first question is, when did you think of writing the book? And did you have an aha moment? What was the process like?
You know, immediately when you, I'm going to just be totally honest. When you first resign, or when I first resigned, I was suddenly hit with, oh, wait, I'm not getting a paycheck anymore. And it's not like there's any savings whatsoever from, you know, a congressional salary and having a house in Southern California and an apartment in DC. So I was like, I got to figure something out fast. And I had a whole bunch of people saying, well, you got to write a book. And I'm like, okay, but I don't, what am I going to say? And then there was an aha moment of, I think that, you know, the most important thing isn't my own story, but it's how my story is reflective of what so many other women go through and how it needs to be a call to arms to say that we have to do something drastic in order to make the changes that are necessary. And in my view, that's all about electing women and getting to parity. And until we do that, things are not going to fundamentally change. And there were a lot of things that really developed throughout the, you know, the course of writing it, especially my grandma's story, which I talk about a lot in there. That was one that, you know, I didn't necessarily intend for it to be as big of a part as it ended up playing, but I felt like, as you know, the more I talked to her, the more important it felt to me to kind of tie the two narratives together. Yeah, so I mean, you know, I also had a lot of time that was kind of lost because of what happened with my brother. You know, he passed away in mid-January. My mom had brain surgery, so this is the time that I'm supposed to be writing the book. And because I had always wanted it to come out in time for the 100th anniversary of the 19th Amendment. And so there was just a very short timeline for us to be able to finish everything. And they had to push my deadline till the absolute last second for the publication date to work out because, you know, I obviously couldn't work on it for, you know, a while. So I really hunkered down and wrote the thing in like 3 weeks. It was quite an experience.
And did you enjoy writing before?
Yeah, I was actually an English major, Funny enough. So I and my jobs early on in the nonprofit sector were writing related. And it's definitely something that I've always written some to just kind of process things. And I kept a notebook to write about, even while I was in Congress, just to kind of write about, you know, experiences. And so yes, the writing was fairly natural for me, and that's why I didn't need a ghostwriter. I did need help researching because there was a lot of just, you know, heavy research in there and help in terms of kind of, you know, editing and putting it all together in a way that made the most sense. But yeah, it's definitely my writing. So
yeah, it didn't have that boring feel that politicians' books often have. So
I'm glad
it had
a
nice natural feel to it. So that's great.
Could you talk a little bit about your decision to resign? Because in the book, you stress a lot about, and it's very convincing. You know, you're obviously, there's a lot of resentment towards your ex-husband, towards the way the press behaved, towards Red State, towards the Daily Mail. But ultimately, you did decide that there was reason enough that you actually had to resign. We had Alex Morse on the show last week, who talked about how he kind of came up against the edge of deciding whether or not to quit and ultimately decided not to.
Yeah.
Was there a moment like that for you, and what pushed you over the edge?
Yeah, there was. And for, you know, 2 weeks I was fighting it and saying, no, I'm going to stick this out. But the barrage of the images and the articles and the leaked text messages and the fact that they said that, you know, that there was just going to be more and more coming, I felt like it was never going to stop if I didn't take myself out of the picture. I thought that it was going to continue to have this terrible impact that it was having on my staff. You know, my staff is like, they're completely in the dark. They don't know what my response is going to be. They don't know, because I didn't even know what my response was going to be. They didn't know what was true, what wasn't true. And once there's something that's claimed that you admit to, right, the part that I admitted to in terms of the consensual relationship, then I think it really made people question everything else. And even though those things weren't true, so I felt like I was up against that as well. And my family was being harassed. My mom was being followed in these trucks, and my sister's business was getting attacked, and my staff was getting stuff sent to the local office. They had white powder sent to them, and my friends and colleagues in Congress were getting, you know, bombarded by these questions about me too. Are you going to support her? Or do you think, you know, blah, 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 blah. And as we were going into impeachment, especially since I was the, you know, the leader of the freshman class, I felt like I was going to be used as this distraction and also as this liability for Democrats and especially for freshman frontliners. And the moment that changed me, or that made me finally decide to do it, is that I was in personal agony. I mean, I was miserable. I was, you know, the most depressed that I think I've ever been, and just shamed and horrified and guilty about everything. And my mom, you know, I think I talk about this in the book, but I just had this conversation with my mom about it all. And she's like, you don't have to keep putting yourself through this, and it'll be okay. And that felt like it gave me the go ahead to resign. But I still wonder sometimes if I should have stuck it out. And the biggest time that I questioned that decision was when the Republican defeated the Democrat in the special election to replace me. Because I honestly wasn't expecting that. I thought that we had won by so much, we'd won by 9 points, that the district had really changed. And, you know, lots of lessons learned from that. And I'm hopeful, really hopeful, that we flip it in November. But, you know, after that, I was like, what was this, you know, another huge mistake that I stepped down? Should I have stuck it out? And I don't know that there's a right answer, right? You know, I don't think there ever could be, because I still felt the weight of possible hypocrisy, of, what it was putting people through. And so I think that would have certainly continued if I'd stayed in, you know. But then there's also I know that I was doing good work there, and I know that I was, you know, contributing. And if we had been closer to, if we didn't have the majority by as much as we did, then it would have been a total different calculation. And also, I've thought about it more, and I think that even if I'd been in office longer, or if I'd been a more experienced candidate, or somebody who'd even been in other offices before, it might have been different for me. It might have been, you know, something different to have gone through. But the pictures really just make a huge, huge difference. The fact that you're kind of, I didn't want to go outside. I didn't want to, you know, I didn't feel like I could face the world with that. So yeah, it was a very difficult decision.
It sounds like, though, that if some time passes, some parts of that calculation are going to dissipate. You're no longer going to be potentially a distraction to an impeachment hearing. The heat of a media hurricane is going to recede a little bit. It sounds like that leaves the door open somewhat for a return to politics, perhaps down the line when the circumstances have changed some.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that it's impossible. I think that I've found a path for now in terms of the work that I want to do. You mentioned the funds that I'd raised for my reelection. Many politicians, you know, either who resign or who lose in a reelection campaign, they keep that campaign money in an account that just sits there, so that if they do run for federal office again, they can just use it. And I had about $1 million, which is a lot for, you know, a competitive house race, you know, for any house race. But I thought that, you know, I had an obligation to all the people who had donated to me to convert that into something that was meaningful. So I converted it into this political action committee called Her Time. And the work that I've been doing on that, you know, really, it dovetails so much in the book. And, you know, I was able to use the book to kind of even outline the mission of the work with Her Time. And so we're supporting these candidates, not just in presidential elections, but to vote for women in every single election. And then we're going to be championing and advocating for these legislative issues that are outlined in the book too. So that's a lot of work. It's something that I'm really excited about, and it's something that I think we can make a difference in, because there's not an organization. There are organizations with complementary missions like Emily's List, but we are targeting a very specific set of of goals and of the kinds of people that we're supporting. So, you know, I want to make that successful. I want to set that up to be, to have a big impact before I move on to anything else. And, there are so many amazingly talented women, women of color, women who haven't had the opportunity for their voices to be elevated yet, that I don't feel like I need to insert myself again, anytime soon. If there's a gap, if there's something that I feel like maybe down the road makes sense, I'm not going to say it's impossible, but it's not on the priority list right now.
How do you describe what happened? Because there's so much, I feel like we often don't have the language appropriate to describe things. So lots of things get called a scandal, and sometimes things that are not scandalous, like actual, and this wasn't the case for you, but everything from like sexual assault to a totally consensual extramarital affair, they all get lumped into this group of sex scandal or sexual scandal. So there were a lot of different things happening, right? There were the photos, there was the relationship that you were accused of having, which you didn't, there was a relationship that you did have. How do you describe it? And I actually asked you because we were recording the intro and I was like, I want to give her the chance to kind of use her own words, which you do in the book, but I wanted you to give you the chance to use your own words, like, you know, verbally. So just so viewers and listeners know.
Sure. I have come to just kind of, for lack of a better phrase, call it a scandal. Mm-hmm. And basically call it a sex scandal, because I don't know what else you could refer to it as, especially because mine involves many different aspects, right? I think that, you know, of course I don't love it, but I also am pretty sure that if it were somebody else, I would still refer to it as a scandal, even if it weren't something that I thought, you know, that the person was at fault for. It's still a scandal, right, nonetheless, right? Like Monica Lewinsky was still involved in a scandal, even though, you know, wasn't necessarily her fault. So I think that is the term that I've come to use. At first, you know, I was calling it the incident or the, you know, the situation or things like that. But after a little bit of time, I was just like, yeah, that's a scandal. And I'm on the very short list of women who have been involved, of women politicians who have been involved or taken down by a sex scandal. There are plenty of women who have been on the other side in a political sex scandal, but not the politicians themselves. So there's not a lot of us.
Yeah, I was just thinking once you said that.
There was a woman from, she's a Republican who was the majority leader of the Minnesota State Senate. And she's pretty much the only other one that pops up if you're looking for it. And I think, interestingly, since I resigned, I heard about a woman who was a mayor of a city in the South who had revenge porn or cyber exploitation happen to her too. And she did not resign. And I was happy for that, because I think that maybe my, you know, what happened with me might have drawn a little bit of a precedent, line in the sand, and said that this is not something that the women should be at fault for. Right. And if you want to, basically you should decide whether I should resign, not based on those photos, but based on, you know, other aspects of the situation.
So when you say that, do you mean, the relationship that you had with your female staffer, is that the thing that made you, I get that the photos made you feel terrible, but for that relationship, would you have stayed?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. But I do know that, you know, I did feel a lot of guilt around that. I felt, especially because I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to be painted as this hypocrite. And even though at the time and ongoing, I didn't feel like there was this power differential, especially when it started. And I certainly didn't feel like I was in the same category as, you know, Harvey Weinstein or any of the other ones. But I had to kind of come to terms with, but I get why, and I get that the accountability that we have come to expect from people in these kinds of situations, whether they're men or women, like I'm kind of setting the tone in a lot of ways. I was kind of the first woman in a scandal like this too, in the post Me Too era, right? Like the relationship that I was in had started before any of the Harvey Weinstein stuff. It had started before the the Me Too hashtag had even become big, right?
Right.
So it was, I think it was, I was right in that shifting moment, and it's still happening, where we haven't fully defined what we intend for that to mean and who it should apply to and how it should be applied. But especially because of the fact that I was in that, you know, I w- even though I was a victim, I was afraid of what I was, if I didn't acknowledge that and if I didn't step down, was that suggesting that it was okay, right?
Yeah, I mean, maybe I was reading into this too much, but in the book, you use the present tense when you talk about how I know that this, that it was inappropriate to have that relationship. Maybe it suggested that you didn't know at the time, maybe, yeah. Or that you came to a realization. What changed your mind about that? I mean, did you have some new thinking about what the dynamics were of that relationship as this was breaking, or what happened?
Definitely. And just over the course of time in general, right? But like when it had started, and I have, you know, I was in a management position, an executive level position at a large organization for a long time before I ran for anything in politics. And I was, you know, it never would have even occurred to me to have any kind of a relationship with someone I worked with, right? That was totally off the table. But in the campaign, and I think this is a combination of the turbulent relationship that I was having with my husband, the amount of time and proximity you spend with people, the fact that it was such a small and grassroots team, like there were literally three of us that were working on it at the time. And so I didn't feel like I was in a position of power, right? I didn't, even though I should have recognized that I was, I didn't. At the time, it didn't feel like that. And so I think that's a big part of the realization, right? Is that I didn't set those boundaries with my staff. I didn't see myself in the way that I should have. And some of that didn't come until later, until I really was in this more powerful position of being a member of Congress. And even then, you know, there was a long time that I felt like, you know, especially with my staff that had worked with me during the campaign and that had been basically colleagues, the way that I saw it was I didn't feel, and frankly, they didn't in a good way, like they didn't have any fear of talking to me like I was a peer, right? I felt like I got good feedback because of the fact that they weren't afraid of me as a member of Congress. So I think that, you know, it's a whole bunch of kind of factors coming together that made for like a perfect storm. And it certainly was not something that I recognized at the time. You know, I recognized other potential problems with it, but not that I was like exerting my power over somebody.
It's funny because it's like it's almost a sign of progress, right? In terms of women and LGBTQ issues that, cause I think with an older man, like with a male candidate, it's kind of a clearer, it's a starker contrast, you know, than it is, I think, with two women probably.
Yeah, two women, and both of whom, I mean, I was, you know, I wasn't even 30 when the campaign started. And so, I think it's the age difference. It's the fact that you're, I think as a woman and as someone who has been on the receiving end of assault by men, like I'm not conditioned to think of myself on that side of things, right?
Are we in like a new media environment where with the internet can now make life basically unbearable for somebody in the right circumstances, and that can become the determinant in somebody's political future, like, you know, in the blink of an eye? Is this a new reality for people going into politics? Like, people have to be ready for that if they're going to enter into it now. What do you think your story says to people who are maybe thinking about going into politics?
Yeah, I've struggled with that a lot too, right? Of how do I tell people, yeah, this happened to me, but you should still do it anyway. And the way that I've kind of reconciled this is like, well, what happened with me is pretty much the worst case scenario. So prepare yourself for this worst case scenario and think about how you would handle it if it happened to you. That's part of my problem, right? Is that I think this is a simple, you know, human denial or even a level of naivety that I had. I didn't run that scenario out fully. Maybe I didn't want to, but I definitely did not play that out entirely. Like, okay, if this comes out, how am I going to handle it? If this is and part of it, like I said, is a big denial kind of thing. Like even though you know it in the back of your head that it's a possibility, you don't really want to address it as a real possibility because it sounds just so horrifying. But so I tell people, like, be ready for it, get in front of those kinds of things. And if you if you have nude pictures out there, which most people do, like, don't be ashamed of it. And if you've got baggage, come out, come out with it early, because, you know, you take away that power if you do it yourself. And, that's something that I think I wish I had done.
Is it different also now? And I mean, it's possible that people have become so inured to these kinds of incidents that it's no longer fatal to somebody's career necessarily. If something like this happens now, right? I mean, maybe 20 years ago, like, it's, you know, a single photo of Gary Hart was enough to end the campaign. It would take a lot more than that these days, I think, right? I mean,
Yeah, and again, if it were just naked photos, I don't know if that would have been enough. I don't, for me. I think it was the, like I said, the culmination of everything, and the moment in time. But I do think that, you know, as we look at a new generation of leaders, we grew up online, right? Our entire adult lives have been documented by social media, and the nudes that, you know, that are consensually shared are normal, right? That's not an unusual thing at all. And so I think that we are going to have to be desensitized or accepting of these kinds of things. And I also think that, you know, a big part of what people are looking for now, truly, I feel this way in politicians, is someone who's real, someone who they identify with, who's been through the same kinds of things that they have. And it doesn't mean perfection. So I hope that things continue to change, and that we find a way of reconciling that, because I think, you know, especially for women, there are fewer of us. And so we are held to a higher level of expectation for perfection. And even we hold ourselves to that higher level of expectation, but that at a certain point, we're going to have to say, people who we elect to represent us, we elect for the reasons, you know, their leadership qualities, or what we think they can do for us, or even that they do, that they represent us, that they actually represent the things that we are and the things that we've gone through. And that doesn't mean that they have to be this perfect person who's been preparing to be a politician for their entire lives.
How do you think the Democratic Party is doing this week with the DNC? What's your, you know, having been out of it a little bit for a year now, were you surprised by anything in terms of the way the primary race developed and how we got to this point?
Surprised, no. Somewhat disappointed, sure. I think, you know, in even like I have a lot of respect for the people who've put together the convention and how difficult that has been, right? I think that evolving and adapting it to this moment with COVID is just an incredibly challenging thing. But there are some things that I think really show the split between an older base of Democrats and the younger ones. So I was talking with somebody earlier that, you know, a lot of the speakers that they've got, you've got Kasich and Clinton, Bill Clinton and Colin Powell, and, you know, these people who do not have any appeal to younger progressives at all. And in fact, are very off-putting. You know, if you already feel like you have a concern about progressives and younger people showing up in November because you've got Joe Biden at the top of the ticket, then to me, it seems like a bad move to not be elevating these younger, more progressive voices more. And I feel like in a way, Alexandria was set up for the controversy that happened with hers, because people didn't understand this, that she was going to be up there to second Bernie. And that was like, I feel like that should have been a, that really should have been a something that was kind of publicized beforehand, that the role that she was playing, that her speaking part, her 60 seconds was in fact to second Bernie Sanders nomination. Or
do you think that was genuine? Because I felt like there was a little bit of triangulating going on there against her. In other words,
that's what I mean, is that I think that, and I don't know who was responsible for that, but I felt like it was a bit of a setup to make a controversy that wasn't there. And I don't, you know, again, I don't know whose fault that was. I don't know if it was a media play, or if it was a genuine accident, or if it was something that someone just didn't think about and should have. But I really think that the campaign needs to make an extra effort to generate that excitement, or at least acknowledge that the party is moving in a different direction. We've seen it with the Mondaire Jones and the other, you know, the other folks that have won in these. Yeah. And So we're going to have to acknowledge that. And it's not a great way to do that with what they've done so far in the convention. So Kamala is a great pick. Still wasn't the favorite for progressives. I endorsed her for her presidential campaign from the very beginning. So I'm a big fan, but you've got to recognize, like, all right, there are these shortcomings that we've got with a big part of our party. How are we going to coalesce them? And what are you as the DNC, you as the whoever's in charge of any of these things, doing to appeal to them and to say, we see you, we hear you, we recognize that things are changing and that we want you to be a part of it.
What about this sort of generally Trump-centric message of the DNC? Like, you know, reading your book, one of the things that's appealing about it is that you basically say of charts of lists of positions that you take on things. This is very clear. Here are like five things we're going to do: paid family leave, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. There was so little of that so far with the DNC, yeah. And so much of this emphasis on the, you know, our opponent is an existential threat, et cetera, et cetera. It makes me wonder whether they're trying to stress, or whether they're running from this idea that we stand for something.
Yeah, I think it's. I get why, right? And I think that, you know, what's going to motivate people in November, including progressives who might not otherwise have any desire to vote for someone like Joe Biden, they're going to do it because of this anti-Trump sentiment, because that, like, we have this really overwhelming sense that our country is not going to survive another 4 years of him, or that our democracy is not going to, that the post office isn't going to, that all of these things that we hold dear will not make it if we do not get rid of this guy. So I think that the motivating factor, and we've seen this in polling, we've seen this in other qualitative studies that we've been looking at. That's the motivator this time around. It is the anti-Trump sentiment that's going to bring most people to the polls. However, when you're talking to me at least, when you're talking to the base, that's who you're talking to at the convention, right? You're not trying to talk to Republicans. Like, I don't know. What else you would be doing, but it would be nice to say or to hear, okay, we all know we have to get rid of Trump. This is something, like, if you're not on board with that sentiment at this point, then I don't know how to help you. And to say, like, okay, but we have a job that we're going to have to do when we get elected, which is to clean up that mess. And I don't want to understate that at all. That's going to be hard. It is a lot of damage to undo in every single aspect, from foreign policy to environmental policy to women's rights to everything that we were seeing around race relations. Like, just cleaning up and undoing the damage that's been done over the last 4 years is probably going to take an entire term of the next presidency. But we should at least say, okay, here's how we're going to do some of that cleanup, and here's some of the things that we're going to prioritize. The House in the 116th Congress, we passed these huge measures that would fundamentally impact our political system and have laid the benchmark for when Democrats are in power, this is what we can do. We passed paid family leave. We passed the Equal Pay Act. We passed raising the minimum wage. We passed the organizing. I mean, most of the bills that I put in there are ones that Democrats passed. So there should be, to me, there should be a recognition of that, and saying, if we win all of these Senate seats, we've got an administration that's going to sign these bills, and that's huge. So I don't think you need to lay out this massive new vision that we haven't heard before, but just say, these are things that you can count on if we're in charge.
I mean, I think that the Dems, I mean, I'm very cynical about them. From the left perspective, not from the right, but they removed something from the platform. There was a fossil fuel pledge.
Subsidy.
Yeah. So they cut the opposition to fossil fuel subsidies from the platform. Not embracing Medicare for all, which is something you did embrace. And I think that, something that I think the Dems get a lot of mileage out of just running against Trump. I don't think it's enough. And I think it's a way to not actually do certain things that their donors don't want them to do.
Yeah.
And you get to say how terrible he is. And, Pelosi rips up the speech and.
Yeah.
And people aren't wonks. You don't have to have, like, all the data and all the numbers. But I do think just explaining,
Yeah. And you even have things that you can point to that you can say. That literally, if we maintain the majority in the House, these are the things, there's right. Like list gun reform, you can like literally just list them off and be like, these are already set up. The bills are written. They have already passed one branch, they passed the House. They need to pass the Senate. So if we get the House and the Senate, we should knock those out right away. It's going to be the same majority. There's no reason that if it passed before, it shouldn't pass again. And I think that pressure should be there immediately. And we should hear Biden and Kamala say that within 90 days, we can sign some massive bills and, you know, tell me that wouldn't inspire some people, right? Like, even if it's not something as huge as Medicare for All, which I know is going to just be I know from the technical side, like how you actually craft that policy, it's going to be a freaking nightmare. And I'm not even talking about the lobbyists that are going to be trying to mess with things. It's just going to be hard. Yeah. So I see that as like a lot of work, and whatever the next healthcare policy is going to take us closer and closer to that. But you know, so I don't want somebody to try and pretend that they're going to get Medicare for All done in the first year or 2 years or whatever, but you certainly can say that you're going to get a lot of these other things done because you've got a legislature that's going to work with you on it.
Speaking of things that are, you know, they're difficult, that are hard, having interviewed members of Congress in the past, a lot of people always talk about when they first get to Congress, how amazed they are at how Byzantine and convoluted the system is. You know, oh my God, I had no idea that the Rules Committee is this complicated, and you have to do these 19 different things in order to get a bill to the floor. What was for you the most surprising or strange discovery upon getting to the House about how that place works?
Oh yeah, the procedures are wild. Like they're not ones that you even that you totally grasp at all. Like there are parliamentary procedures and a parliamentarian who's making sure that you're following all these procedures that most members of Congress like never really get, unless you're part of the Rules Committee or unless you're, you know, you actively have a reason to be involved in these. Those pieces are just insane. I also didn't realize just how things get prioritized and how much, how many things get lumped into these big must-pass bills, like how important appropriations bills are because of what else gets into them. And it's, I don't think that that's a, you know, I don't see it as a bad thing necessarily. I think that when we've got this hyper-partisan environment where Republicans don't want to work with us on anything, then pretty much your only leverage, your only negotiating power is keeping the government open or funding the military. Like those are the two that you can put things into that. So for example, we got paid family leave in for the first time into the NDAA, the Defense Authorization Bill, that I worked on as part of Armed Services. But like, we couldn't have gotten that done independently. We couldn't have gotten that done at all if it weren't for the NDAA. And there are a whole bunch of things within appropriation, increased funding for certain programs, including social programs and these other priorities that, you know, as a standalone issue wouldn't work at all. Not because there's a lack of will on one side, but because there's no ability to do that with the other side. So that was really interesting for me. And it's something that I think, you know, would be helpful for people to understand better how appropriations work. And I didn't even really think about this before. I always thought that there was a negative, that earmarks were a negative thing or, a negative association with it. But earmarks can be really valuable. And like, as a member, you know your district better than anything else. So if you know that like this bridge is super important for your district. I had a specific set of asks for my district that, you know, no federal agency is going to be able to do. So if you're, as a member of Congress, you're supposed to represent your district. If you can figure out how to get in earmarks, I would like to see those come back, and I don't have a problem with them. It's just, you know, you have to recognize that's how things work, right?
And in terms of the armed services, I mean, the military just failed an audit for, you know, that took a million years to even take place. I mean, and the whole story of how it even got there is an incredible shaggy dog tale. Do you have any thoughts as to what can be done to rein in military spending, or B, at least get it to the point where its finances are understandable
and can actually be accounted for?
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Well, a couple things. One is One is that there needs to be a mandate from high up that has consistent leadership, because when you're having turnover of these secretaries like crazy, you're not going to have anyone who's able to who actually follows through with it, who actually follows through with the audit, who is ensuring that accountability coming all the way up. So we had a few different people, you know, the Secretary of the Navy, I thought was really on top of it. The Secretary of the Air Force was really on top of that. They're all gone. And you know, even the, yeah, I mean, just basically the turnover within the whole thing has been unreal under this administration, but it has to be a priority. It has to be something where you're having Congress bring them back again and again and again and saying, okay, where's the audit? What is it? And I would say that we have to set much more, incremental benchmarks than saying audit the entire thing. I would say we need to say, okay, audit this program, or give me the, you know, I would have to look at it to figure out exactly where we should start. But one giant thing is often kind of impossible to touch. I also think that we should look at the military as more than something for defense, because it really is. It is our largest subsidized job program for largely low income people. And that's often glossed over, but it's the military is the way out of poverty for so many people. And it's not, it doesn't have to be a war fighting thing, right? It doesn't have to be under this premise of Save America, World Police kind of thing. I think that what we should be doing is, if we're already willing to pay for a subsidized job program by the federal government, we should deploy those resources and actually call them what they are, and use them for transportation and infrastructure, and use them for, you know, these environmental issues. And that, I think that would be a lot more effective than having troops trained for these military exercises that are never going to actually need to be deployed. The other thing is that there is a very real job issue with each of these things that's getting developed. I was in a district where, and the reason I ended up on armed services, we were major manufacturers of F-35s and of the next bomber. And that would literally employ probably 100, the military projects literally employed probably 100,000 people in my district. So when you start cutting those programs, like, you are losing jobs. And so if you want to do that, there has to be a meaningful transition into what we're funding instead. So it's not as simple as saying, like, we need a 5% across the board cut. It's like, really, where is that coming from? What jobs are going to be impacted, and what can we, you know, how are we going to spend it instead? So I guess I was more sympathetic to military spending because of my role on armed services, and because I recognized how much there were human implications that have nothing to do with, you know, wars in Afghanistan or Iraq or, you know, military preparedness or anything like that. And you get a much better sense of the very real threats that we have, and the whole strength as deterrence as a concept that I didn't agree with nearly as much as I did after having spent the time in the back rooms of, you know, that you getting the intel that you wouldn't get on the outside. Yeah, but it's a major issue, and it's one that, when you talk about big things, yeah, it has to be addressed, because we spend so much money on it that needs to go to other things.
Did you suddenly become extremely popular with lobbyists once you got the armed services seat or the assignment?
Well, I was never extremely popular with lobbyists because I didn't take corporate money. So, right. You know, their leverage is limited. The ones that I was popular with, it was because we had a common interest, because I was already on their side for something, or because I cared about the jobs in my district, or, you know, something mm-hmm. like that. So the Lockheed Martin and Northrop lobbyists did like me because I was going to advocate for those jobs anyway. But it had nothing to do with, like, I never took a dime from them. My predecessor, my Republican predecessor, sure did. And I'm willing to bet you in the very short time that my replacement has been in there, he's probably gotten all kinds of corporate money that, you know, they had saved when they weren't giving it to me. But it didn't mean anything about how we'd vote differently or how we'd represent the district differently. So
anything that you want to say about the Morse story? I don't know if you're caught up on it, but it looks like it was a setup, or a lot of it was fabricated, and some Democrats in the Massachusetts party, at least, were help coaching a few students in creating this narrative. How did you feel when you were observing it?
Well, I think that there's there's this very strong component of still homophobia, or in my case, there's biphobia and the sensationalization around it. I think that that has to really be paid attention to. And, you know, especially now that we do have this issue around Me Too, how is that? People know that that can be weaponized, right? And even within our own party, we know that that can be weaponized. So, you know, if you see someone who's a threat for whatever reason, you could very possibly be dredging up things that imply somebody has done these things that they even haven't, or taking it out of context, or whatever it might be. So I don't know Alex personally. I don't, you know, and I've been following the story as much as I can, but I'm not like intimately involved in it in any way. But I do know that you see these things that are very much tied to, conceptions that people have had around LGBT issues for a long time, and play on that fear or that lack of information. And I hope that we continue to call those out wherever we see them.
Well, thank you so much for coming on. Good luck with the book, was really interesting. And
glad you read it.
And so thanks for taking the time, and maybe we'll check in with you again sometime.
We'll love that. Thanks so much, you guys.
All right. Thanks.
Have a good one.
You too.
All right, take care.
Bye.